you know, when we do the decision to deliver the patients, we will be more nervous when the neonatologist is not available in the labor room. So it's not that you are nervous when you see us. We get nervous when we don't see you. So thank you very much, Dr. Leslie. So we don't have time for discussion. We move on to the next topic, role of probiotics in the prevention of preterm labor. And to enlighten us, we have Dr. Jyoti Shetty, who is currently the professor at Kasturba Medical College. Over to you, madam.
This is actually an adjunct to the progesterone therapy we are going to prescribe. You know, it is very interesting to see that we have all learnt in our MBBS days that the lactic acid, which is normally present in the vagina, is very important to prevent ascending infection of the genital tract. There are many lactobacilli, and the one which is most useful is Lactobacillus crispatus, because you know they are now going into the vaginal microbiome and trying to do a lot of research to prevent ascending infection in the genital tract. Because if you can see a lot of literature coming up about vaginal microbiome. Now there are a lot of studies where the lady is asked to test her vaginal pH, and if she's found that, you know, the pH is more alkaline, that is more than 4.7, it can be easily done like with just a litmus paper test, and then it shows that she has deficiency of lactobacilli. The main objective of using probiotics is to ensure that she has a lot of lactobacilli so that there is no ascending infection. Now I'll go a little bit into the how this lactic acid works. There is a this one called as extracellular matrix metalloproteinase, which decreases the cervical mucus, helps in the ascent of the bacteria into the endometrium. So there is an inducer for that is inducer of matrix metalloproteinase, which is called as Emprin, which is produced by vaginal epithelium, and its concentration is dependent on how much lactic acid she is producing. So summarize this complicated information. When she has lot of lactic acid, it decreases extracellular matrix metalloproteinase inhibitor. It inhibits that. So this makes the cervical mucus more, it keeps the cervical mucus plug intact. So there are no cervical changes and her cervix will remain long. So the main etiology, though, you know, we spoke on all, you know, genes and everything, but in 50% of the patients, ascending bacterial infection is the most important cause. So if any lady complains of vaginal discharge, we have to first look at the type of discharge and treat it. Ensuring that she has a lot of lactic acid will help in the antibiotic. It is like an additional, it prevents more, it is just an adjunct to the antibiotics we prescribe. So by ensuring that she has a lot of lactic acid, we can ensure that there is less chance, especially, you know, if you give one course of antibiotic and then the lady comes back with another episode, is the time when you add these probiotics. Now, in addition, what happens is whenever there is the cervical mucus is broken down, this will help in the ascending infection. She will have chorioamnionitis, and this will trigger the uterine contractions, which is the main goal of adding probiotics. So we can easily determine whether she has lactobacilli deficiency by doing a pH test, and by increasing the we can add probiotics so that we can prevent ascending infection. So this is called as an adjunct, and it's a non-antibiotic based approach to the infection control. This is because, you know, the patients, if you give repeatedly antibiotics, you know, they will, nowadays, you know, the patients are even asking us why, you know, we are giving a second course, third course, because, you know, they are, you know, finding out from Google that, you know, the antibiotics can cause a lot of complications also. So the the main objective of giving probiotics is to ensure that she has a lot of lactic acid, and this will prevent this increases her chance of, decreases her chance of developing infection. You know, sometimes we find that, you know, because we are like recently we had a patient, you know, she was having a very short cervix, and we were trying to find out, you know, though a cervical cerclage was put, still her cervix remained short, and these are the group of women who are, you know, very easily, you know, they can have another episode of infection, and there, you know, there is a role for prescribing probiotics. Now let us see what are the probiotics which are available in our in our setup. There are like Combinorm is one which can be used for about a 10 days course. There are others also in the market like Ultimate Flora. And now I'll just go through the evidence, like what are the recent literature which tells you the usefulness of probiotics. Oral probiotics, especially there was a study in the American Journal recently which says that when the medical representative talks to you about these probiotics, we should see what is the content of it. It should have a lactobacillus rhamnosus. That is the main thing which reduces the lipopolysaccharide inflammatory response in the placental trophoblast cells. And this will reduce the risk of preterm delivery. This is a very useful article. This is even published in the best practice, and it is very effective in preventing preterm birth. Now coming to the Cochrane review, there is a they have summarized all the articles, and this is a review article which tells you that how useful is probiotics. Now they have studied two groups, that is less than 32 weeks and more than 37 weeks, but they found that because the confidence interval is very wide, they found that it is not significant, but you can use it as an adjunct, like to prevent, like because you can buy some extra time by adding these probiotics and reducing the infection. And the number, you know, actually when they went into depth, the number studied was only 88, and there were two main trials which used this probiotics. There is actually the lady will have less infection rate. There is 81% reduction in the risk of genital infection. So she will not come to you with repeated episodes, but they found that they were not able to, you know, prevent preterm birth, and they were not concluding that it is very useful in preventing preterm birth. There is a recent article which is published in 2019 which used probiotic supplements orally. Now, in this, they used oral capsules which contained lactobacillus rhamnosus and reuteri, and they started from when the patient reported to the hospital till the end of pregnancy. This study found that they were actually seeing whether she's going to develop bacterial vaginosis by doing a Nugent score, and they found that oral probiotics were not useful in modifying the vaginal microbiome, because they studied each bacteria and they were found that it was not useful. Now there's another article which is published in American Journal in 2016, and in this article it's called very popularly as effectiveness of probiotics. So it's called the FPRO trial, where they allocated women to one group went into placebo and the other group took orally daily one capsule of lactobacillus rhamnosus and reuteri, because this is the main content, this should be the main content of the probiotic which you are going to prescribe. They found that oral probiotics are not useful in increasing the vaginal health, and it did not have any effect on preterm delivery, and they found that at the end of this study they suggested that it is better, instead of oral probiotics, it is better to give a vaginal application. Like if a vaginal, suppose there are two formulations available, an oral and the vaginal, they ultimately said that, you know, vaginal route is better to prevent the infections. This was published in archives, and this is a very good study where they used vaginally. This was the only study I could find which used it vaginally. All others were on oral probiotics, and here they used Lactobacillus rhamnosus, and they used four parameters in the cervix which helped to prevent, and they were studying each patient by doing these cervical length and other parameters. So you can see here, they studied the pH plus the length of the cervix, the dilatation of the cervix. You can see clearly that, that the cervix remained long, it did not dilate, and the fetal head did not descend. There was usually one sign of preterm labor is engagement of the fetal head. So all these parameters improved when they used vaginally Lactobacillus. So the conclusion was it was effective and it prevented abnormal vaginal flora, and it did not allow the engagement of the fetal head and kept the cervix long and prevented effacement of the cervix. So I would like to conclude by saying that it is an adjunct to the preparations which we are using, especially the progesterone which we are using to prevent preterm labor, and always try to choose the vaginal probiotic, that is Lactobacillus rhamnosus, which is better than prescribing it orally. Thank you. I thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to speak.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jyoti. So finally, I think probiotics are here to stay. It is not that we can just do without probiotics. They are here to stay.
Even for, usually 10 days as an adjunct.
Yes.
Along with progesterone therapy.
As an adjunctive therapy.
Yeah, adjunct. You have to look at the vaginal infections, see what type of infection and choose the appropriate antibiotic. Along with that, this is an adjunct.
Yes. Thank you very much, Dr. Jyoti. So.